Welcome to another live edition of the Pittsburgh Sports Line in the BP TV studio. Thank you for watching us. Appreciate all of you. I'm Al Levine, the talking machine. Got Chip Hayner and Smokin' Jim Frazier here, both on time. Both are here with me, so we've got a great show for you. Thanks for watching us on Comcast 7, only in Bethel Park. Verizon 32 in Bethel Park, and all the way from Nemacolin to Cranberry, Wexford, and all points in between. We appreciate you. Facebook, 6,770 likes. We've been bouncing around in there, up and down 5-6, so appreciate all the likes. Thanks for watching our TV shows. We appreciate it. And thanks for watching us every Tuesday live, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday nights. We appreciate all of you watching our shows. Got a lot of sports to talk to you about, and of course, with there's a lot of action there. First, I want to do a couple promos like I do. First one up is Olive Oils Pizzeria. There we go. Perfect. 412-831-1900. They sponsor our show with a pizza and a hoagie. Give them a call. Tell them Al Levine, the talking machine, said give them a call, and they got great food, great specials. Check out their specials. And they're right at Hillcrest Shopping Center. Next, end each show with Joey Fabus. Joey didn't make it to his ninth birthday. There we go, a little adjustment by Devin Shea. We got Zach and we got Jack helping out. So we got a full crew here tonight. This is Joey before DIPG, the brain cancer. It took his life before 9 years old. You can give money to the Joey Fabus Childhood Cancer Foundation. They're a 501c3. They've raised over $100,000 to try to find a cure for DIPG the last 4 years. So help them out. I know I believe in them. Who can imagine losing their child before their ninth birthday? So very sad. Another 501c3. We got the Bethel Park Historical Society. Schoolhouse Arts and History Center, 2600 South Park Road. It's a big red trolley right there. You can't miss it. They put all brand new windows in the place. They run different events. Santa Claus and Mrs. Claus will be there, I think, on the 15th. So they do different things throughout the year there. Check out the Bethel Park Historical Society.org and see what they have going on. Next, Dave Cable likes to have a little fun at my expense. Put my face on Uncle Sam. Uncle Al wants you for BP TV. You could be like Devin, Zach, and Jack here. All volunteers at the BP TV studio. Call 412-831-3304. I want you for BP TV. Tell Dave Cable, Al Levine, the talking machine, said you want to come in and volunteer. Appreciate it. Next, 501c3 BPCF, Bethel Park Community Foundation.org. Go there, get an application. They have money for you from $100 to $5,000 for your group in Bethel Park and all the good things that you're doing here in our neighborhood. Give them have a request to come there and put your pitch out there and get your money, $100 to $5,000 to help your group in Bethel Park. Can't wait to hear and see. I'm a trustee on the board. All right, we also have a sponsor of What's On Your Mind, Skeets Lewandowski of Skeet Service Station. You can call him at 724-348-4715. He works on anything and everything that runs on gas. Lawnmowers, boats, trucks, cars, of course, weed whackers, you name it. He has a buffet every Monday. I checked it out this week. Not too shabby there. Some donuts from Bethel Bakery. They're very good. Good conversation about boxing and other sports, of course. And we're going to talk about that right now. I got to ask Smokin' Jim Frazier, what's on your mind?
Thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine. And if you want the green,
coming at you.
You got to see Levine. I feel like the Oklahoma quarterback is going. Who got my vote for the Heisman this year. I get a vote for the Heisman. But hey, Al Levine, the talking machine, in the mail today.
Yeah, yeah.
Came the license for my dog. Best $7 I ever spent in my life. And I tell you what, if my dog is half as loyal to me as President Bush's dog.
Hold it, where's your dog even live? Your dog don't even live with you.
I know. But I tell you what.
Come on, man.
Does your heart go out to rest in peace, President Bush, when you see the dog laying down right by the casket? You're talking about
it,
the dog that loved
it. It went all before that,
it.
But that's very sentimental
yeah,
to see his dog.
I love to see that.
And how loyal pets can be. This is why Zach and I have been trying to teach you this over the last 2 months about when you own a dog, you keep a dog. When you keep a dog, you take it to the doctors, you take it, scoop up its poop. You feed the dog. You do all the things that an owner
I got a license.
You're just a name only. You're name only. You're like somebody that owns a building and rents out all the floors to it. You don't live there.
But I tell you what, Al Levine, the talking machine.
Get serious.
real quickly about the Pittsburgh Steelers, and I've been saying after the first week, they'll be 1-and-done at 9-7-1, and it looks like I was correct, and I know me and Chip go at it a little bit about the Pittsburgh Steelers in that, we said they were a mediocre team talent-wise with an extraordinary quarterback that was drafted by Bill Cowher. And if you look at it, Kevin Colbert does an excellent job drafting on the offensive side of the ball, but that's only one-third of the team. The defense is horrible in terms of not...
Hold it. Who drafted the best linebacker you ever saw?
Exactly, but he's yet to draft a Pro Bowl cornerback, and that's been a problem year after year. And the special teams is amongst the worst in the league. But we'll get back
we'll
into...
talk to them Steelers.
But also take into account that a certain Chin never drafted a Pro Bowl quarterback. Or, I mean, a...
cornerback?
Yeah, he never did.
Yeah, you're right.
Well, that was Chuck Knoll, because Bill Cowher won with Chuck Knoll's team.
That's why the Chin will not get in.
well, what's on my mind is...
no Chin in.
is the top 10 most overrated heavyweights, boxers of all time. 10C, Alonzo Highsmith, remember him? How about 10B? Mark Gastineau, who was 18-0 at one time before they figured out that they was paying for setups to be knocked out. Mark didn't
is
know.
That
he
new,
was just
is
knocking
that new
out.
To boxing?
That's he.
That's not new
he
to
made
boxing.
A, he could have made a lot of money, poor thing. I always like Gastineau. How about number 10, Andre Ward? How about 9C, Zab Judah? How about 9B, Oscar De La Hoya? How about number 9, Floyd Money Mayweather? 8B, Terry Norris. Number 8, Sugar Shane Mosley. How about number 6, Earl Hide and Go Seek Spence? Earl Spence in there at number 6. How about 5B, a guy that I really, really liked?
Who?
Dwayne Bobic, name from the past, huh, Chip? How about number 5? Ken Norton. How about number 4? Ed Too Tall Jones in there. How about number 3? Mark Breland. Number 2? Floyd Patterson. And number 1, and I told everybody that 3 years ago, Fury would have beat him. Tyson Fury would have beat him. And now Tyson Fury actually beat him, but they fought to a draw. Deontay Wilder. The number 1 overrated boxer of all time.
Floyd Patterson was a former heavyweight champion, correct?
Great, great champion.
So how could he be overrated if he was a champion?
How can he be overrated? Floyd Patterson won the Olympics as well. Was a great fighter. But if you study Floyd Patterson, there were certain styles, like Sonny Liston, that was not good for Floyd. And Floyd Patterson, when he won the belt, Customato kept him away from all black fighters.
Kind of what Money Mayweather did.
Exactly.
I think
that's
he
why
should
he's
have been number
list.
1 on your list.
That's why he's on that list. I love Floyd Patterson. a great fighter, a great guy, a great American citizen, but he was overrated as a champion. There's a few guys that could have beat him, Cleveland Williams, you know.
That's one guy.
Jersey Joe Walcott.
Whoa.
Ezra Charles. All a lot of the black fighters in that era, they kept him away from. Fought him overseas, fought a lot of the European fighters and stuff like that. Great heart, quick hands, but he had a suspect chin. I'm glad he never fought Rocky. He might not have ever gotten up. Thanks. And that's what's on my mind.
Thanks, Smoking Jim. Chip Hayner, what's on your mind?
Good evening, everybody. And I will have to agree with Jim Frazier on one thing, or maybe not so much. He thinks that the Pittsburgh Steelers are an offense that's built around an exceptional quarterback. And I have a different opinion. And I feel this very strongly, and Sunday night was another example of it to me, as well as the week before. But I think the Pittsburgh Steelers have an exceptional offense built around an average quarterback. I think that as the older Ben gets, I think the less he's studying, he doesn't know where he's putting the ball. His throws seem to be off the mark, and you know, you got Justin Hunter, who,
when he's throwing the high ball, look out.
Well, you know, and he's throwing probably to one of the best receivers that anybody has ever thrown the ball to in their career by being blessed by throwing the ball to Antonio Brown. And Antonio Brown, for whatever reason, he outperforms receivers that are 5 and 6 inches taller than him. And he goes up there and gets the ball. You've got a young emerging talent as the number two wide receiver, who, if something were to happen to Antonio Brown, would fit right into the number one shoes in Juju Smith-Schuster. You know, they do need that third wide receiver. Martavis Bryant was not the answer. Martavis Bryant had too many things going on outside of football for him to really be as good as he could be. And I hope he gets his life in order so that maybe you know, he can be a productive part of society and have a good NFL career. But the NFL career would be the least important for him, because it doesn't seem like he seems to be his own worst enemy. Continues to keep shooting himself in the foot, which gets me right to the Pittsburgh Steelers. And once again, the Pittsburgh Steelers were beaten by the Pittsburgh Steelers on Sunday night. Mm-hmm. That's the second game in a row that they should have won. And they lost, and they've got nobody to blame but themselves. Sure, the referees made some bad calls, but I don't think there's a game that's ever been played where referees aren't making bad calls. It's really nice when we benefit from them, but the bad calls were not the reason why we lost that game. You know, we came out misfiring in the first half. I think there was at least a couple of touchdowns left on the field that could have been had in the first half. And as it turns out, we needed those points in the second half, because how can you be somewhat good in the first half and so bad in the second half? I just don't get it. You know, I watched the game through my eyelids. I went to bed, I closed my eyes, and it was 23-7. They scored just at the end of the half, and I'm thinking, great, they're getting a ball to start the second half. You know, we're gonna put another score on them. They're pretty much gonna cement this win away. Didn't happen. Phillip Rivers, all he did was pick apart the Steelers secondary. Was he 13 of 16 in the second half? You know, you're not gonna win a lot of football games playing like that. And now we go west, in a place where the Steelers have traditionally not played well. And the Oakland Raiders are nothing short of a train wreck right now. And I think the biggest problem they have with that team is the head coach. you know, he got rid of the number one pass rushing linebacker in football, Khalil Mack. And then the very next week says, well, we need to have a better pass rush. Well, you just gave away the top outside linebacker in the game. You know, it doesn't seem to make sense to me. Look what they did with Amari Cooper. You know, here's a number one wide receiver, could be on anybody's team. Did you happen to watch what he did on Thanksgiving Day? You know, why you're giving up players like that and stockpiling draft picks.
He's 24.
Well, you know, you're stockpiling those draft choices. And if you want to wonder how well that stockpiling draft choices works for you, take a look at the Cleveland Browns record for the last decade, okay? Now, there is some upside. They got rid of that that train wreck of a head coach, Hugh Jackson, who, if the planets line up right, could be the next head coach of the Cincinnati Bungles for the next 10 years. Because if Mike McCarthy can lose his job for losing to the Arizona Cardinals on Sunday, tell me how Marvin Lewis can keep his job in the NFL. I don't understand it. But, you know, just some thoughts and things that were on my mind. We've got a lot of sports to talk tonight, so I'm going to pass it off to Alan.
Well, I'll make it a trio with the Steeler talk. Worst loss in Steeler history at home. Up by 14 points. They've never lost a game like that. They were like 220-0-2. I mean, who do you blame? We always look at the coaches. Yes, they're at fault. You got to look at the players. How do you come out playing so well and do nothing in the second half until it's almost too late? Big Ben's overthrowing guys. They wanted Justin Hunter to give a good shot. Well, he did. He broke open twice and was open like nobody was within 10 yards, 15 yards. How do you overthrow him when you're a superstar quarterback that will probably be in the Hall of Fame since he has two Super Bowls?
Do you see Brady overthrow a receiver that's that open?
No.
Do you see Drew Brees overthrow?
No.
What about Jared Goff? How about Pat Mahomes?
How about Phillip Rivers?
How about Pat Mahomes?
Hold it. How about Phillip Rivers?
These are people that I consider to be exceptional quarterbacks this year.
Well, my thing is when they ask him, does he have any concerns, he said none. So it shows me that I'm glad he has a short memory for interceptions. But what's he thrown, about 9 or 10 interceptions in the last three games? How do you win football games when you're giving the ball away more than others? And then we got some problem on defense that, hey, it's great. We got a great front. They're rushing. Linebackers are getting some sacks and whatever. But we don't get any turnovers. Not one turnover. What's happening there?
Interesting fact. In the last, I think, 25 years, there has been two teams that have gone on to win a Super Bowl with more turnovers on their season than they've gotten. And the Steelers right now are a -8, and I'm not saying that I feel that they're strong enough to make it to the Super Bowl this year.
We don't know what they're going to do next week.
You know, here's the thing. It's frustrating about them. They're a good enough team to beat each one of their next opponents, but will they?
Yeah, it does make you wonder, and I got to go from top to bottom, from coaches, players, everybody, even the ball boy. I don't know what he's doing, but, you know, they're all screwing up. I mean, I watch it. I bleed black and gold, but that was one of the worst games that I've seen, let alone what their record proved it was one of their worst games. How do you even play or not play like that? And then to top it off, we're all happy about Connor and the year he's had. The last couple games weren't so good. This one wasn't too bad. Harry gets hurt, and we don't know what injury it is. It was a contusion. It's a broken ankle. It's a sprained ankle. We don't exactly know what it is, but he's off for this week. So here we go. People are dissing Le'Veon Bell, greedy and all this. Good thing he's not here. I wish he was here.
I don't.
He might be in shape in the next week or two and he could play. But the opportunity was, in the way the CBA was supposed to work, that he should have been here, and that's my point to it. But we're done with him. I'm glad he's gone. He outlived his usefulness. And we'll sink or swim with Connor or Jalen Samuels or whoever will jump in. What's this committee Tomlin's talking about running? They usually only run one back, so I can't wait to see the committee that Tomlin comes up with.
Trey Edmonds, he's going to be the diamond in the rough.
Well, we shall see. That's what's on my mind, and we'll be back with some fiction and fact from Smokin' Jim's Almanac.
You know, guys, I really want to thank you for all the work you've done for me this year. You've really helped me catch up on all of my holiday programming.
Sure, no problem, Dave.
You know, if you're bored, you don't have to stay here. You could always go do something fun.
Oh, thanks. Hey, where's you going to, Dave?
This should be interesting. Ugh. I know you guys are disembodied spirits, but it's a little cold for us people with bodies to be playing out here.
Oh, come on, Dave. You used to play in the snow when you were a kid, didn't you?
Well, at least let me go get a hat.
Gloves, too. Merry Christmas and happy holidays from all of us at BPTV.
Uncomfortable.
Hard to ride on that thing, huh?
It is hard.
Thanks, Al Levine, the talking machine, and Chip. Glad to have my man back, Devin Shea, and the rookie of the year, Zach Taylor's here, and Jack as well.
Yeah.
The fiction and fact from Smoking Jim's Almanac, I'll split it in half.
What?
I think locally, when I was growing up, it was, Myron Cope had a great radio show.
Yeah.
I think Mark Madden is the guy people listen to now. But in the day.
They truly don't.
The guy I thought on TV that had the best show was Sam Nover.
Yes, sir.
And Sam Nover just passed away at 77.
77, a young 77.
I still have an old interview on VHS tape. They started showing some of his interview one time, about maybe 10, 15 years ago, of Roberto Clemente.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a great, great interview.
I meant to mention Sam in my opening, and it slipped my mind, but yes, he did pass. And 30 years, he was Channel 11's sports director.
I thought it was longer than that, but me and Sam used to hang out a lot at the North Allegheny football game. So.
Really?
Yeah, I think he had some people in the band and whatnot, but we used to watch Gateway rubbing
there?
In their nose, you know?
Who'd you have at North Allegheny?
I was just there watching Gateway dominate. But what's fixing in fact from Smoking Jim's Almanac is I'm going to talk briefly about Roger Craig, and remember that name. Mm-hmm. Roger Craig was a guy who nobody knew could run the football when he was at Nebraska because he was the blocking back for I Am Hip. Remember the brother named I Am Hip?
Yes, I do. Yeah.
And also the Heisman Trophy winner, Mike Rozier. But he gets to San Francisco. They found out that not only can he catch, not only can he block, but he was a heck of a runner, and I think he'd be in the Hall of Fame. A guy that reminds me a lot of Roger Craig, not that he high steps like him, is Jalen Samuels. Watched him a lot at North Carolina State. This was a guy that's tough. He was a tight end. He was a wide receiver. He was a fullback. He was an H-back. And when he carried that football, he showed he was very special. He's the closest thing I've seen in the National Football League in the last 30 years to Le'Veon Bell. He can run every route that a receiver can run, a tight end can run.
He goes down right away.
No, he steps good. He scores some touchdowns. Look for number 38, Jalen Samuels, to make a name for himself here.
Coach Tomlin today at his press conference mentioned that the arrow has been pointing up for him, and he's earned his playing time. And unfortunately for James Conner, this is the way things go in the NFL. Usually it's somebody's misfortune is your fortune, and it's his opportunity
here's
to shine.
Here's something else before I pass it on to you, Chip. Here's something else to know about Jalen Samuels. He's not a brittle brother. And that's
good
the deal. Fiction and fact from Smoking
good
Jim Romanek.
Good stuff, Jim.
I checked out his bone structure.
Thank you, Smoking Jim Frazier.
All righty. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to my trivia segment. And last week, I heard being talked about on the radio of a list that had come out. And unlike my dear friend to my left, Jim's list, I'm going to give you a top 15 list that includes 15 names, okay?
No, not just 15.
Just 15 because it's a top 15 list. But what I'm going to give you, and this was a list that I pulled, I had to do a little research today and pulled it down off the internet, of the top 15 head coaches of all time in the National Football League.
Wow.
Okay? So we will start. Where do you want me to start? At the beginning?
The bottom.
At the bottom.
Rock bottom.
At rock bottom. Number 15.
Any black coaches on that list?
You'll find out. Number 15. Head coach of the Washington Redskins, George Allen, who had a 116-47-5 record as head coach. He had a 7-12 winning percentage.
Over the hill, gang.
And that was number 15.
Okay.
Number 14. Do you want to get him a little oxygen bottle? Because I'm sure he's going to hyperventilate when he hears this one. Mike Tomlin. Pittsburgh Steelers, career record 122-62-1 for a 662 winning percentage.
Token pick.
Well, you can say what you'd like. The list is a list. Number 13, Bill Parcells, 172-130-1 for a measly 569 winning percentage.
Wow.
100 points behind Mike T.
Wow.
Next up, Roger Craig's former head coach, Bill Walsh. They called him the genius. 92-59-1 for a 609 winning percentage.
I thought you were starting at the bottom and working your way.
I'm working my way from number 15 to number 1. Next up on the list, an icon in Dallas, Texas, Tom Landry. 250 wins, 162 losses, and 6 ties for a 607 winning percentage. Next up, somebody that dominated the late 40s and the early 50s in the NFL, Coach Paul Brown, whose record of 213 wins, 104 losses, and 9 ties for a 672 winning percentage. And he won 7 NFL championships. And those 7 championships were won by none other than?
Otto Graham.
Otto Graham. Very good, Jim. Number 9 on the list. He was so good, they named a stadium after him.
Whoa.
And I will just refer to it as the Frozen Tundra. Curly Lambeau, head coach of the Green Bay Packers, 226-132 with 22 ties. For a 631 winning percentage and 6 world titles to his name.
I need that list.
Mm-hmm. Number 8, Tony Dungy. Dungy made number 8 with a career record of 139-69 for a 668 winning percentage, just slightly higher than Mike T's.
How many losses does Dungy have?
69.
Okay.
Next up on the list, number 7. He only coached for 10 years. He only won 1 world championship. And people probably know him better for the game that's named after him.
Madden.
Head coach John Madden of the Oakland Raiders. His record was 103-32-7.
Wow,
he had a winning percentage of 759.
That's high.
75% of his games he coached, he won.
What a coach.
That is
that's
big. That's big. Next up on the list, the another coach of the Washington Redskins got a little more notoriety than the first. Joe Gibbs.
All right.
154-94, 621 winning percentage, 3 Super Bowl championships. Now we get to the top five. Top five. These should be easy for people to follow. Number five, Chuck Knoll, the Emperor, whose career record was in the regular season was 193, 148, and 1. He had a 566 winning percentage. He won four world championships in the 70s.
Who's next, Mike Ditka?
Next would be none other than the person that the Super Bowl trophy is named after, Vince Lombardi. A winning winning percentage of 96 wins, 34 losses, 6 ties, a 738 winning percentage, and 5 world titles.
Yes, sir.
3 NFL championships, and he won the first 2 Super Bowls. Next up on the list, Papa Bear, George Halas. 318 wins, 148 losses, and 31 ties for a 682 winning percentage. And George Halas won 6 championships.
31 ties.
31 ties. Now we're getting down to the final 2. And this man has more wins than anybody else in NFL history. Be none other than the head coach of the Miami Dolphins and the Baltimore Colts before that, Don Shula, 328 wins, 156 losses, and 6 ties for a 677 winning percentage.
He got more losses than anybody, too, huh?
Well, you know, and if you look at what Chuck Knoll did, and most of the losses that Chuck Knoll suffered, he got in the last probably 10 years that he coached. You would think about
that 1-13 the first year didn't help.
Well, it didn't help, but it laid the foundation because that the building block was there.
Yeah.
Joe Green. And number one on the list, one of the most hated men in this city, the Hood. Bill Belichick with a 257 wins, 121 losses, a 680 winning percentage, and 5 Super Bowl champions.
Wow.
So there you go. That is the top 15 head coaches of all time in the
NFL.
Thanks
for your honesty and your correct count.
I told you.
Appreciate
when I give you a list of 15.
I liked it.
Thank you very much, Chip. We appreciate it. No location show on the 9th next week. We're on hiatus from Olive Oil's Pizzeria December and January. We will be back February 11th. That's 930 Brookline Boulevard, 7:30 to 8:30. So check that show out. We'll keep reporting. We're looking at a couple locations, got some talks going on. We'll see what happens, and maybe we'll be in your neighborhood near you. So stay tuned. We're still trying to go on location, but if not, we're here every Tuesday night, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, just for your pleasure. So enjoy the rest of the show, and we'll be back with some Steeler conversation.
And to this day, Chris, Scrooge is synonymous with greed or miser, which just goes to show you the impact Dickens had on the English language.
He's a hack, and his portrayal of ghosts is borderline offensive.
Huh. Oh, hey, George.
Who's this?
Oh, this is the Ghost of Christmas Chris. Christmas Chris, did I say that right? That's a bit of a tongue twister. You sure you don't want to change it? All right. Well, anyway, Chris here has been helping me out this holiday season.
What do you need him for when you got me?
Maybe because I can do this.
So what? I can do this.
I can see through walls.
So can I.
I can haunt the courtyard.
I can haunt the halls.
I can make myself as big as King Kong.
I can make myself as big as Godzilla.
Well, I can reenact a scene from Ghost.
Can you get this penny out of my face?
Well, I can reenact the scene from Ghostbusters. It's time for me to show you the door.
Oh yeah? You and whose army?
Fellas, is this any way for holiday spirits to behave?
I guess so.
Alright, come on, show a little Christmas cheer. That's much better. And I'm glad we got that squared away, because honestly, you're not the only two ghosts helping me out this year.
I'm not gonna fight with him.
Welcome back, folks. We did talk some Steelers between all three of us to start the show. I don't know what else we got left here, but I'm just disappointed there. I don't have much faith in them and what's going on. I'll see what happens. They seem to surprise us because they do have some talent, and it's just when they get on the same page, and they haven't been on that page because you have a quarterback that doesn't really care where he's throwing. So, I mean, he's even admitted it as much. He doesn't remember about interceptions, which that's good, but then he goes and throws that high ball. Like, who would think Justin Hunter would be on the injured reserve list because a ball was overthrown when he was 20 yards wide open? So you got to give the kid credit for trying to make a catch. But to get injured like that, it reminds me of a little baseball slide into second base. Gregory Polanco slid into second base like smoking Jim Frazier played T-ball.
Right, but Gregory Polanco did that to himself, and even though Justin Hunter injured himself, had the pass been thrown where it should have been, he wouldn't have had it.
But I mean the effort that he put in. He did put the effort in there.
He did. Oh, he did try. You give the young man credit.
Well, only thing I know, Martavis Bryant would have had to slow up to catch it. He's so fast.
Martavis Bryant wouldn't even been near it in the right neighborhood because he looks like Tarzan, can't even play like Jane. That's how I look at
it.
And he got a two-cent brain.
Yeah,
how
but
does
that
your
was
man
4 years ago,
two-cent
Jim.
Brain?
You, know, you, can't, you can't bank on what you did. It's what are you capable of doing
now.
It doesn't even matter. He looks like Tarzan. And he don't even play. What the heck?
He wasn't fast enough to make it to all them drug tests he missed.
Unbelievable, smoking Jim. A rule breaker and no respect for his own life, let alone what he should be doing. Who cares what he looks like? It doesn't matter. He's done. He's out of here.
Well, the Steelers' problem, main problem is...
Main one? I got to hear this.
Is that the Steeler fans, some of the Steeler fans take a better head button than the Steeler players does. When they get punched in the mouth, they begin to fold like a card table. The special teams is one third of the game, and it's horrible. How can you jump off sides three times? Every time you jump off sides, they get moved up closer. And then you got Artie Burns. Not only does he jump off sides and don't know that he jumped off sides by 5 yards, but he dives past the kicker, and the kicker makes the
field goal.
We got a punt returner that's not fast. Probably the slowest black man in the NFL. He runs all the way 80 yards or whatever for a punt return touchdown. You were asleep then, Chip.
I was.
And the Pittsburgh Steelers are giving up an average of 15 yards per punt return, which is the highest in the NFL.
And even besides that, I mean, besides the, you know, the block in the back that they didn't whistle on the play, that being said. But I tell you what I think the biggest problem that Steeler teams in general, and I'm even talking about Steeler teams of the past, let's say the last 20 years. You know, the Steelers only seem to respond when their backs are up against the wall. Now, here's what happens. The Pittsburgh Steelers win 6 games in a row. Now, all of a sudden, everybody's talking about the Steelers, how they're one of the best teams in the AFC.
Yeah.
Okay? Now, all of a sudden, Hey, guess what? All the hard work we put into win those six games, hey, we don't have to worry about that. We're shoo-in for the number two seed. And what do? They beat themselves 2 weeks in a row. Now their backs are up against the wall. Baltimore is a half a game behind them for the division lead. Okay? Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've got, you know, some people say the Steelers would be lucky to go 2-2 on the way out.
Just the go Steelers with smoking Jim Betts.
The Steelers have to win at least three of their last four games.
Really?
And I believe that they have to if they're going to have a chance to win the division this year. And that means that they're going to have to beat either New Orleans or the New England Patriots. Yeah. Okay? Now, everybody says, yeah, okay, we should beat the Raiders. Yeah, we should be. But all about you give if I had a dollar for every team the Steelers should have beaten and lost good to, point. I'd probably have a couple of bucks in my pocket. No, I'd be a rich man. I would definitely be a rich man. And I, you know, can the Steelers beat, you know, the Patriots or the Saints? Either of those teams can be beat, and they have been beat. Okay, look at what the Saints happened.
How
to the
did
Saints.
The Saints only score 10 points
there
the
you
other
go.
Night?
It can happen. It can happen.
Well, I believe NFL sports are fixed.
Well, you could. Yeah, you
that's
know.
Why I don't bet them because I believe they're fixed. How do you have a point spread? And then you have a guy that's averaging 37 points a game.
Maybe you could bring a guest on the show for us next week. Maybe we can grill Macaroni Tony. see if he can enlighten us, you know?
He can wear something over his face.
What do you think, Jim? You talk to him? Yeah.
But I just seeing a game like New Orleans losing, that's a fixed game. There's no doubt about it.
But once again, you know, the Steelers' own worst enemy is themselves. You know?
You're not supposed to make mistakes like this. And for three offside calls, maybe the first one wasn't an offside call. That might have been debatable, that first one.
I didn't see nobody.
But the next two, they definitely were offside.
And I mean, if you're going to get that many penalties, you may as well at least get your money's worth. Somebody clobber the kicker so he can't kick the field goal.
Yeah, good point.
You know,
referees missed an obvious one. I'd have thrown a guy out of the game for leading with his head. When Sean Davis wiped out number 23 at the goal line, man. Our own player friendly fire. That was the hardest hit. I've never seen a hit. That was an interception. He had it. He had the interception in his own man.
Sean Davis was doing his Mike Mitchell impersonation.
Yes, he blasted him. And it went up in the air. And the kid for
Keenan Allen
for San Diego catches it. Yeah, and Keenan Allen's surprised they didn't have a linebacker on him.
That's the question I'm going to ask you. Now, Keenan Allen was targeted 16 times, and he had 13 catches.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Why, in any defensive scheme that you've ever seen in your life, would you put a linebacker on another team's number one wide receiver?
Number one wide receiver that's 6'2", that's having a great year with a great quarterback.
That just doesn't seem to make any kind of sense
None.
At all.
Well, no, here's the one thing. I could understand us being stupid at the beginning of the game. But you go into halftime and you go, this guy's killing us. What do most people do?
Make adjustments.
Yes. What did we do?
Nothing.
We kept it the same. Yeah.
And then you have an all-pro outside linebacker. You finally get one. In the last 10 years, you can't draft an outside linebacker. You finally get a T.J. Watt. And you got him in pass coverage most of the time. Let him get after the quarterback.
His brother
can't block him. His brother's a fullback.
Give him one block on the first play of the game.
The one guy in that Steelers defense that I was very impressed with. I don't know what his first name is, but his last name is Fort.
Yeah, he played his butt off. 54.
He blocked the punt.
He blocked the punt.
I mean, the guy was all over the field making plays. Now, where did he come from?
Practice squad, mostly.
You know,
they cut him in training camp.
Well, he
does is make plays. He's a tough kid.
Yeah, I mean,
Dirty Red is probably better than him.
He didn't even get in the game.
They won't play because they don't like his red hair.
No, I don't think that's it. I think he's injured more.
And look
often
at Chickalo. Chickalo was playing decent, and then he got injured.
Chickalo plays. He's better than two play to it. He doesn't get more than a half a dozen plays on a good game without getting hurt.
Right.
You know? I mean, the guys are great football players.
Who?
Chickalo and Medakevich are good football players. They don't stay on the field long enough.
Medakevich, he got hurt last year. He's healthy this year. They don't like his red hair.
They're keeping him strong.
The biggest prejudice in this country is against guys with red hair.
Okay. We're talking sports, folks. We're not talking about the state of American
prejudice.
Injustice.
My point is, how do you not double cover Allen after the second half starts?
How does that not happen? Why are you covering him with a linebacker?
Well, even if you got a linebacker, I bring somebody else up on him.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. You know, if you got Jerry Rice on the other side of the ball, what are you going to do? Put your defensive lineman on him? I mean, come on. Yeah, you're going to put Devon Hargrave on him, right?
Yeah. No, but I mean,
and don't expect Phillip Rivers to find them. Yeah, Phillip Rivers got 9 kids at home. He find everybody.
He got one on the way. He got 8 kids at home. Nice picture. One on the way.
That's nice. I like him. Always liked him.
Yeah, they said be fruitful and multiply.
He has done that. Getting back to the Steelers, they're not multiplying, and just some of it you got to blame the coaches, because what adjustments did they make in the second half? Because we didn't do anything.
Well, you know, here's the way a game boiled down, and I really didn't see any of the second half. I've been listening and I've been reading, and, you know, the Steelers, Los Angeles Chargers were making plays in the second half, and the Steelers did not. Yeah. You know, Antonio Brown had an incredible first half, and then, you know.
How do you start the second half? We get the ball, 3-and-out. Get the ball again. 3-and-out.
Wow.
Get the ball again, 3-and-out. Wow. You know how many yards we gained in those 3-and-outs? 15 yards.
That's crazy.
I'm watching the game, and I'm like, this is ridiculous. What we were doing in the first half, we're not even trying in the second half.
And, you know, and it's funny.
How does that happen?
Ben takes responsibility for calling the plays when they go right. When the plays don't go right, well, that's Coach Randy.
Look at how he tried blaming.
He's going to throw a guy under the bus like that.
Look at how he tried blaming Brown for when he had that interception that Brown didn't go straight. Yeah. Well, when you look at it, Brown didn't come in from the end zone.
Is it Antonio Brown's fault that he's quadruple coverage and you're still trying to thread the needle with him when you've got 4 guys picking their nose at various portions of the field wide open?
Right. Good point.
You know? And it's a shame Vance McDonald dropped a couple passes. He had suspect hands before he dropped the ball a couple times.
Dropping passes like that, the lack of concentration. They're not following the play through to the end. They're thinking, okay, the ball's being thrown to me. What am I going to do? Or what kind of an end zone dance am I going to do? First, you got to catch the ball and you got to get in the end zone. Then you worry about what you're going to do.
McDonald had, that was one of my apprehensions when we got him, because he had a history of dropping the ball.
Yeah.
And the point you guys keep missing is this is a very average team with a Hall of Fame quarterback that was drafted by another coach.
Who's not playing like a Hall of Fame quarterback that was drafted by another coach? He's not playing like...
He's got twice as many touchdowns as he has.
What does that say for Mike McCarthy?
I don't know.
He drafted Aaron Rodgers.
I don't know too much about white on white crime. Did he draft it, Rodgers?
Yeah, that's right.
He won a Super Bowl.
He did, and Aaron Rodgers and Aaron Rodgers was changing his plays, the plays that McCarthy called in the huddle. Aaron Rodgers changed. Yeah, but now he says, "Oh, I can play for any coach except the one you just got fired."
Wow. And he missed them out wide open. I think he missed them on purpose.
You know,
There's some wide open guys, and he missed them.
One of the things that drives me crazy about sports today, when anybody has a good game, they're the greatest that ever lived. And you know, and when they have a mediocre game, you know, they just kind of poo-poo
There's
it
excuses.
Off. Look, either are you the greatest in the world, or you're not the greatest in the world. Okay, and if Aaron Rodgers isn't the greatest quarterback, you know, then, okay, I could live with that. But, I mean, we want to hang the moniker of, well, Ben Roethlisberger's a Hall of Fame. Well, you know what? Let him finish his career. Okay?
You guys did a lot of that.
5 years after his career ends, we'll find out if he's good enough to be in the Hall of Fame.
Well, you guys did a lot of that with James Conner. You guys have any regrets about that now?
What do you mean?
I have none.
Everybody,
I didn't say much.
Look at Connor's stats. He's just as good as Le'Veon Bell.
No.
He may be better than Le'Veon Bell.
Hold it. His stats were actually better than Le'Veon Bell.
This isn't a James Connor about, Le'Veon Bell. Le'Veon Bell wasn't going to play this year, okay? We had an opportunity. We offered him a contract. He turned it down. He promised that he would play for the money that he agreed to pay for on the franchise tag, and he lied to everybody.
Well,
okay?
He didn't lie to me. He told me he wanted to be in Pittsburgh 2 years ago.
Well, you know what? And I hope that after the season's over that the Steelers follow through on some recourse, because there has to be something the Steelers can do to not let him get away with what he's doing, because I think if he does, it's going to create a problem. And actually, to be honest with you, I think it's going to void the collective bargaining agreement. And if that's the case, the players will get locked out immediately.
I think he may be getting an apartment in Indianapolis as we speak. Who's the other team? Maybe Kansas City would be a good fit for him
right now.
Would you now?
Yes, they would.
Let me ask a question to you guys. We know none of us like anybody that hits a woman.
No.
But I think
I'm already answering your question right now. No.
Can be rehabilitated. I don't think. Would you bring him in?
No, because he lied.
Kareem Hunt.
He lied about this from the beginning.
He's a young kid.
He has no remorse.
Young kids lie.
He has no
remorse.
I heard
the apology. You know what? He apologized.
He didn't apologize for what he did.
And you know what he did? He also said the Kansas City Chiefs did the right thing. And here's what the thing is. I'm paying you millions of dollars. Yeah. And I demand that you tell me the truth. And don't tell me that you can lie to me and it's okay. That's the same thing Le'Veon did with the Pittsburgh Steelers. And that's the reason why
you
I don't ever want to see him again.
You don't think Kansas City is lying to us? If TMZ can get that tape, you don't think the NFL already had that tape? I think Kansas City had it. There's a police report, everything. Kareem Hunt paid that girl off. That's why she pressed charges. And all of a sudden, TMZ...
They're living together.
They could have waited till after the season.
They're living together. He's living together with her.
Not the girl that he kicked in the butt.
I think so.
No, that's the girl that dropped the N-word. Nah. Maybe she dropped the N-word.
I heard she's living with
him. And not the strong E-R.
It doesn't matter.
If I own a football team and I'm paying you millions of dollars to represent my football team, and you're going to lie to me and think that it's going to be okay that I can sweep
But he didn't lie to the Steelers. Would you pick him up if you're the
not
Steelers?
Not a chance.
He's still under rookie contract. That's a you
Nobody
not
picked
money.
Him up
you're
on waivers. Did you see not what the announcement was?
I'm just saying, if you were the Steelers.
No. See, you know what? Daniel Snyder doesn't own the Pittsburgh Steelers.
Okay.
Now, he picked up Reuben Foster last week, who was – the second time he's been
with domestic
violence.
That's the second time.
That's the second time.
What
well,
happened?
If you, guess what? If you do it the first time, the second time's going to happen.
No, because you can't say that.
No,
you
I just
can't
did.
Say that.
I just did.
He just did, smoking Jim.
Come on, there's nobody.
I don't want him.
Huh?
I don't want him. I'm against all abuse.
Yeah, but
I know you're not, but
no,
I am again.
But, I mean,
you
I think,
just tell a story.
I don't think he'll ever do it again.
I'm against all type of
NFL
abuse.
Is a privilege, not a right. And if you had that little
you
regard.
You never flipped out before?
Never.
I mean, not on a – you flipped out before.
Never. You know, you didn't get raised in the house that I got raised in.
Now, I'm not talking about hitting a woman.
No.
I'm just saying flip out.
No.
I was not
allowed to behave like that. My father would have made sure I never did it again.
You're a white guy. You mean to tell me you didn't go over the speed limit and see an open road? Every time I got in the passenger seat, that's flipping out.
No.
That's what I mean. I'm not saying hitting a woman, but you never did anything.
You changed subjects. You changed subjects.
Oh, my buddies, I used to be scared. Open road, 120 miles an hour. I'm like, I'll never get in this car again.
And
you've never done that? Yeah, you have.
What does that even mean?
Because we all make mistakes.
There's a line that can't be crossed.
Okay.
Abuse is the line.
So you saying that he should never get a job, he should never be employed?
No, if I was the owner of an NFL team, I would never sign him.
Chris Carter used to be on cocaine and all kind of hard drugs. They put him through rehab in Minnesota. Now he's on TV.
And he's in the Hall of Fame.
And he's in the Hall of Fame. This guy, hey, I believe it.
No tolerance.
Give him a second to put him through training. Put him through what you got to put him through.
I'll let him wait 10 years, then we'll talk to him.
Oh, my goodness. Really?
Yeah, 10 years. Second chance.
Did they give Ray Rice a second chance?
He didn't punch. Ray Rice punched that lady. He never punched her.
He made a mistake, didn't he?
Huh?
He made a mistake, didn't he? He hasn't done
but
it since.
But he wasn't young.
He hasn't done it since, has he? Why did he not do
but
it again?
But this kid's 21 years old, 22.
Well, you know what?
Ray Rice was 30.
Sometimes you got to learn painful lessons in life.
When you 21, 22?
And I certainly didn't.
How many women did you hit?
Did you guys ever drink before you were 21?
How many women?
Never. I never hit a woman.
All right. That's what we're talking about.
A lot of women spank me, though, but I've never hit a woman. But did you drink before you were 21? Did you drink? No, you know you had a drink.
A teetotaler.
Oh, man.
Smoking Jim, you're changing subjects like usual. No.
Get him. HBO, help a brother out.
Since we've gone way off the tracks, let's talk a little bit of Penguins. You know, the Penguins are, right now, they're number 13 out of the 16 teams in the Eastern Conference. And you know what that would get them right now? Not even a playoff spot if the season were to end right now. Top eight teams make it. The Penguins have a lot going wrong. They have issues with their goaltending. They have issues with their defense. And they seem to have trouble putting a puck in the net.
Yeah, who would think?
So other than that, I think they're doing great.
They're not even mediocre right now. Come on.
Mike Rutherford made a trade yesterday. He traded Daniel Sprong, who was supposed to be an up-and-coming star. He averaged 2 points a game in the juniors. And then when he was in the AHL last year, he averaged a point a game. And then he can't even get on the ice.
No points.
He can't get on the ice. I don't know what it was Mike Rutherford did not like about him. But,
Sullivan didn't like him.
Rutherford loved him.
Yeah, Rutherford liked him.
So,
Sullivan,
you know, we got some help that we desperately need in the defensive court, but now we got to start playing consistent. The fact that we could lose to the train wreck called the Philadelphia Flyers Saturday night baffled me completely.
Well, I'm hopeful they can turn it around, but they need so much work that it's unbelievable. Just, it's tough watching them play. They're just terrible. They truly are. All around, they can't coordinate anything.
I get sick of hearing this, with all the world-class talent that they have, this should not be happening.
Yeah, on that note, keep watching. Don't give up. Go Steelers. Go Pens. We're going to end this show. This is Al Levine, the Talking Machine, Chip Painter, Smoking Jim Frazier. Please stay Joey Strong.